Hi. So thank you. Thank you, Ron, for the lovely introduction, and thank you all for coming tonight. So as you've heard, I'm relatively new to Vancouver, and one of the things I've noticed as a newcomer here is the high level of public engagement around issues of real estate and urbanism. So more than just being in the news a lot, it's something that the general public and audiences like this seem quite curious about. If we're not talking about the weather and the rain outside as cocktail party chatter, it's probably real estate that would come up most often. So I'm happy to be here and kind of launching the book with such a real estate and urbanism savvy audience. So I set out to write this book long before anyone with a background in real estate was running for president. And I finished it, to be clear, before the primaries of 2016. But don't worry, we will cover a little bit of that topic here tonight. So what I started with instead were questions about a few things to do with how the form of American cities had changed over the course of the 20th century and how real estate development figures into the history of architecture. They are connected, and I will explain how. So too often in reading in the history of architecture, I find myself really unsatisfied with the link made between a great design and then its realization in steel and concrete and glass. The elision between an inspired drawing and the completed project left out the step of, quite frankly, who paid for it. So given the total aggregation of what gets built in the world, why would someone make the financial decision to support progressive or avant-garde architectural design? And what did it mean for design when that support came from a source that doesn't look like a traditional client? We're comfortable with the traditional model of a client as kind of muse to the architect's artistic practice, but we're uncertain how to frame that client when the client is a corporation, say, or when the project might be something we would call speculative. So something that's built more for a generalized set of architectural conditions rather than for, say, Edith Farnsworth. So the character of the real estate developer, despite its ubiquity, troubles the simple relationship between architect and client. And architectural history hasn't offered us a terribly good set of models for understanding or making sense of it. So then the form of cities has changed. I'll vastly oversimplify this as a shift from perimeter block buildings, seen on the left, to towers in the park on the right. So with the model for perimeter block buildings, we would build straight up to the edge of the property line. We would put the front door directly on the sidewalk. But by the mid-20th century, we use a lot more deep setbacks around buildings, insulating them from each other and separating them from the life of the street. So we see this in downtowns, as these slides show, but we also see it at the edges of cities where it appears a little bit different. But simultaneously, here you see gridiron streets giving way to curving roadways in the suburbs. And I think the seeds of what would come in downtown urban renewal projects in the mid-20th century were actually driven by what had been happening in the decades previous in the suburban context. So of course, the reason for these big picture shifts in modes of land development are varied and complex. But I contend that by understanding the figure of the real estate developer in this tableau, we will have better grounds for comprehending change in urban form, and more broadly, for understanding this relationship between architecture and capitalism. So I'd first like to just offer you a kind of overview of the contents of the book, and then we'll go into some detail about a couple of the chapters. And at this point, because there's never a good point for this, I'd like to acknowledge that the graphic designers on the book, I think, did an excellent job. So this was designed by Office Luke Bowman, who really put a lot of thought, I think, into how they put together the elements of what I had done in my research. So the book is in two parts. Part one studies the suburbanization and professionalization of real estate developers, and then part two looks at a set of case studies around post-war urban renewal. So part one prefaces this suburbanization of downtown with case studies of a suburban developer and a story about the birth of a professional organization. So chapter one, which I will talk about in some detail tonight, focuses on a case of an early, very influential 20th century suburban developer in Kansas City named J.C. Nichols. Chapter two then turns to study how developers, both suburban and urban, working together, created professional organizations to standardize their field and to start influencing public policy. So really, this is the story of the founding of the Urban Land Institute, which is an organization still very active today that you probably know well for its promotion of kind of best practices in real estate development. Part two then contends that the large-scale financing and urban renewal programs allowed real estate developers to start testing their urban visions. Three case studies explore this from different angles. The first, in this image, is in Pittsburgh, and it's a project that was instigated by life insurance companies and adopts some modern and some suburban, we could say, attributes. A second, and this is another I'll talk about tonight, is situated in Chicago and Detroit and embraces a case of modernist architecture and shows a shift to life insurance companies as major funders of post-war urban renewal. Then the third chapter of this second section profiles projects in New York, Denver, and Washington, D.C. To look at urban renewal projects that were done by this flamboyant kind of character of a developer from New York City pursuing an explicitly urban agenda. So this evening I'm going to present two of the cases from the book, two of the chapters. This suburbanization chapter about what was happening at the edges of American cities, and then the second chapter, which is about the architect Ludwig Mies Manderoa and the developer he worked with, Herbert Greenwald. So it's kind of an odd fellows combination of chapters that I'm going to offer you, the kind of least sexy suburban case and then the much sexier version of high modernist architecture to try and make this argument about what I thought cities were doing through this course of the 20th century, making the case really how downtowns became more suburban. So if I'm interested in trying to tell this story about how cities have changed over time, I'm going to make a kind of claim here about how I do that. So if we want to understand the shift in urban development patterns that was away from those perimeter block buildings in downtowns toward towers in the park, I'm going to say that we have to understand what was happening in these suburban subdivisions of the early 20th century. So I think this case really will take us actually into thinking about what it means for modernist architecture, even though it might look like we might be headed more towards the discussion of something like McMansions. So why should we care about suburbs? Suburbs were really a site in the early part of the 20th century where developers could test out all of their ways of doing things. This was kind of opportunity to refine the ways that they practiced their trade and to figure out the best ways of taking a piece of land and turning it into a profit. So as we know well in Vancouver, I think, there is an ongoing negotiation between the public sector and the private market over who gets to put controls on development. So should city planning policies shape control and shape new construction? And to what degree, then, should the private sector participate in setting those policies? So I contend that we have to go back to this early 20th century period, as city planning was also just coming into its own in North America, to see how the terms of that struggle were originally laid out. So rather than coming from things like the civic center plans of the City Beautiful movement, the most vociferous case for private market planning came from the outskirts of town. Suburban developers really pushed for private modes of planning to complement the work of a city planning office. So really, it was the private market that was putting more controls on development. So in the early 20th century, two competing ideas rose to prominence, and those were zoning and deed restrictions. So zoning we know pretty well. It offered a public process, a government policy that could control land use and direct new construction that could align with a broader city plan. But the deed restriction offered another kind of method. This was a private practice. It was essentially a contract between buyer and seller that could control many things from land use to building setbacks. So a deed restriction, if you don't know, it's a clause that would be added to the contract between buyer and seller. And you could put all kinds of limitations in those clauses. So you could set property setbacks. You could set the kinds of land use that would be allowed. And for a long time, you could also specify the race of the inhabitants occupying the land. So as a private mechanism for controlling development, real estate developers were very keen to figure out what kinds of limits they could put, how much they could kind of push this mode of privatized planning to see what it could really offer. So one such developer who did this was Jesse Clyde Nichols, J.C. Nichols. Nichols worked in Kansas City, beginning his career in about 1904 until his death in 1950. And he laid out thousands of acres of suburban subdivisions on the southwest side of the city. He's well known for building what was called the Country Club Plaza, which was one of the earliest shopping centers in the country. But he's also known for the construction of the Country Club District. And this was just a massive conglomeration of subdivision upon subdivision full of single-family homes. And its suburban landscape of curving, tree-lined streets filled with gracious and middle-class homes that has had surprising longevity, so the prices on land here are still quite high, and stability, so the prices have stayed quite stable. So this is what I'm going to be talking about today. So Nichols is one of the most important figures in the history of suburbanization, not only because of what he built in Kansas City, but also because of the work he did nationally, organizing real estate developers, advancing their case for professionalization, and for being one of the founders of that organization I mentioned, the Urban Land Institute. So the Urban Land Institute still today gives out an award that is the Nichols Prize. So he is still a kind of important figure in that world. But infrastructure is important here too. So in the Country Club District, the work that Nichols actually did was to build suburban infrastructure. So more than constructing homes, what he did was he laid roads, he built sidewalks, he buried water and sewer lines, he subdivided lots into land. So much of this work was subterranean and it was contractual, right? He was writing contracts to sell these pieces of land. But it also did have a decidedly aesthetic component. So what the suburb looked like mattered quite a lot. And there are two ways in which it mattered. The site plan and the curvy streets that they would draw mattered as a way to contrast the hard edges of the city, the kind of gridiron city. Also, the experience of then driving these curvy roads mattered, right? To see the kind of leafy landscaping as you would drive through the city. So we could think about American City Forum as aligning along two possible paradigms. One would be the gridiron city that we know well, and the second that's appearing at this during this time period are these cul-de-sac forms, right, the curving streets of the suburbs. So in some ways, we could see this as a kind of parallel to that story I'm trying to tell about the perimeter block building and the tower in the park. So this is a kind of analog to that. But what I'm curious about is this. Why is it that the cul-de-sac persisted for so long, and why was it so resolute a format? And then how did the planning of the Country Club District and Nichols' use of deed restrictions contribute to this cul-de-sac landscape in the United States? One way to understand that is to know that Nichols used landscape architects. This was not common for developers at the time, but he hired landscape architects who laid out the subdivisions, designed the green spaces in them. And whether these were really something like eye candy or whether they were, you know, kind of providing just something pleasant for you to kind of appreciate and enjoy, I think that really we could make a stronger case to say that actually these enhancements were an aesthetic device to ensure the stability of the prices of land, of property values, that could be maintained then through the deed restriction and through the homeowners association, another thing, kind of device that he contributed to. So Nichols himself didn't really see his investments in plant material or decorative statuary as a sales tool for moving empty lots, so much as he saw them as an infrastructure that would bring long-term dividends. In this way, the leftover spaces gained productive value, signaling as well as ensuring through their aesthetics the high values of the surrounding properties. So this was the goal, right? Produce steady property values for his purchasers and insulate them from the dangers of investing in real estate. So early on in his career developing these suburban suburban neighborhoods, on a piece of undeveloped land, the Nichols Company built a temporary sales building for their offices, and they called it, this is it, their Little White Colonial Office. And I think we know well what these are like because we have presentation centers in Vancouver. So this is the presentation center of the early 20th century suburb. It was a sales building. It was built of wood frame construction, existed only for a few years, but it mixed the appearance of a residential building and the kind of symmetrical pomp and circumstance of a small civic structure with a little flagpole. It was already a sales tool itself. The small building's design suggested the genteel tradition of an elite suburb, Palladian windows at the ends of two protruding wings of the building, a small pediment over the central door, roof cornices, many large windows, kind of curving stone walk that carries you out to the street, and then a pair of domestic fireplaces as kind of bookends on the building. This is the edifice that greeted potential buyers and projected the aesthetic standard that the Nichols Company imposed on its subdivisions. The landscape architects working in the suburbs would design curved interior streets, the small park areas that were part of the subdivisions. They would design a hierarchy of roads, so kind of arterial roads and then the smaller streets for neighborhoods. They worked to accommodate the topography, but also, of course, to maximize the number of saleable lots on a piece of land. And the role of landscape architecture in Nichols' work reflects a long-standing and significant association between picturesque ideals and residential design. So it's part of the professionalization in landscape architecture, pushing away from the associations of feminine ideas of gardening was key to legitimizing the work of men in the field. But this gendering did not remove the picturesque aesthetic, so commonly understood, both then and now, really, as suburban. Histories of U.S. suburbia have shown how this picturesque represented a timelessness, a kind of escape from the city and its industry. The landscape designs of suburbia held a central meaning intended to provide separation from the domestic sphere of the home and then the stability against the fluctuations of modern capitalism. Likewise, it connoted the elite gardens of the English that secured a kind of cultural hegemony. As scholars have shown recently regarding picturesque suburban cemetery designs of the mid-19th century, the creation of a timeless domestic space of permanence and rest for the dead explicitly countered the hustle and the unpredictable market of the gridiron city. And indeed, one of the landscape architects that Nichols had hired to work on his subdivisions was a cemetery designer before opening his own landscape architecture firm. So the soft edges, the gentle curves, the lush greenery, all of this was really to hide the kind of harshness of the speculative market and suggested something of the sublime in its place. So if the goal is about the kind of economic exclusivity, the enhancement of lot values, then the tool that Nichols employed to attain that was landscape architecture. So to further this aim, certain construction details were calibrated to attract the most high-paying buyers. Nichols paved the roads of his subdivisions, matching his commitment to landscape architecture with a commitment to automobility. He disliked the monotonous and the gridiron, pothole-ridden city, which conjured for him too much the kind of rough edge of capitalism. By contrast, then, his well-paved roads and sidewalks were highlighted in the advertisements for the district to illustrate its readiness for the car. Nichols' landscape architects used another kind of design to sell buyers a vision of the high-end suburban living. And this was the kind of decorative statuary in these little parklets, and you can see one of them here. So here they are paving the road in the subdivision, and here's this little statuary fountain sitting in this small little curved parklet, which you'll see again on the next slide. So small circular park appears again here. So they would have these opening parties when one would be kind of new piece of sculpture would be unveiled and everyone would come out and kind of participate in the spectacle. So the neighborhoods, the traffic directing street layouts created these small little postage stamp sized parks, little islands that would be surrounded by roads, which these wouldn't be sites that could make much money, but Nichols actually tried to turn them into selling points by filling them with these fountains and sculptures that he believed helped build a longer term vision for the quality and financial stability of the area. So here you can see a little bit what the kind of smaller segmented plans of the subdivisions would look like, where in the kind of layout of the existing Jeffersonian grid of farmland that he would buy up and then convert, the kind of outside boundaries would remain as straight streets, but then the interior streets would get these kind of curving patterns, moving the traffic through, creating these little parklet spaces. And this image I've always quite liked because you can see very clearly this line of trees that cuts through, right? Marking the kind of previous territory, probably between two farms, before the landscape architects came in and right, kind of drew their curving lines around those trees. So back on the deed restrictions, those private market controls on development that he, Nichols, and others were championing as a complement to zoning, deed restrictions were something that Nichols promoted to control land use, setbacks, to enforce the whiteness of residents, minimum costs, construction standards, materials, colors, landscaping, really aesthetics, like all of it together, right? So if you don't know much about how the deed restriction works, then this chart on the left is a description of the part that most people have heard about if they've heard about deed restrictions. This is about the race of the inhabitants. So it's a chart outlining different subdivisions by different developers in different parts of the United States, and then the language which was used in those deed restrictions to restrict those properties. So they might say Africans, Mongolians prohibited. They might say Caucasians only. They might say Negroes barred. They might say Asiatics and Negroes barred. So there are different ways that they would describe the kind of racial component of these deed restrictions, which sat in place and lasted until they were outlawed by the Supreme Court in 1947. So this is the part that we pay a lot of attention to, rightly. But there are other parts of the deed restriction too. So this is a table showing you all kind of on the left column a number of different subdivisions again, and then along the top are all of the different components that those deeds could control. So it wasn't just race. Race was just one of those columns. There were a lot of other things that they did. So Nichols was one of the developers. While he borrowed from an existing set of practices that many other developers were doing. He looked to really extend and finesse this device of the deed restriction. Deed restrictions before Nichols would expire after a certain period of time, and the inhabitants of the community could come together and vote to renew those restrictions. Nichols figured out how legally to make it happen that they would automatically renew, meaning that these restrictions would exist in perpetuity until such time that the entire set of property owners in an area came together and decided to vote them out, which was unlikely to ever happen. Also, he helped invent the homeowners association as another device to kind of maintain in perpetuity the maintenance of common properties, to keep the kind of enforcement of these deed restrictions ongoing, even after, say, the development company had gone away, disappeared. So Nichols had accumulated over 1,000 acres by 1908 when he ran these advertisements at the bottom and posted this sign at the top. And over the following decades, those acres would be built out by homeowners, home builders, and owners. His marketing efforts underscore the obsession with this long-term investment security that he wanted to guarantee for buyers. And the language reflected really consumers' concerns in a volatile real estate market rife with speculators, their investment in some property might disappear. The substance of these restrictions then played off those concerns and were a central focus of the sales pitch of the Nichols Company. So property values rise and they fall. And from the late 19th through the early 20th century, they rose and fell with alarming frequency and degree. So Nichols's obsession with steadying what was a home buyer's largest lifetime investment made a lot of sense. And Nichols had a really fabulous way for framing this struggle that I've always liked. In 1923, in a speech, he said, "Real estate was unstable merchandise." So he was a good salesman, right? And the goods that he tendered could drastically change in value in very short order, right? This was unstable merchandise that he was selling. Developers and bankers believed that these stricter restrictions were favored by property owners because they were designed to stabilize that unstable merchandise without zoning regulations and without deed restrictions, without the authority of a city planning office, right? We're talking about land outside of the city limits. Then a home buyer in the suburb really had no assured expectations that what would happen in the developing properties nearby them. So not only would the bank be more likely to renew a loan on a covenant-restricted property, a deed-restricted property, but noxious industrial or commercial tenants couldn't move in next door to you. So these protections not only contributed to segregation in housing, as the racially restrictive clauses I described did, and perpetuating a pretty long-standing form of racial injustice, they also offered the developer the obvious incentive of greater profit. So the big picture conclusion here. The shift that we see in Nichols from that cul-de-sac paradigm of urban form rests largely on concerns about market volatility. Setbacks enhanced through deed restrictions were put into place to protect owners and to protect the banks who held their mortgages from financial ruin. The real estate developer relied on private market planning procedures, deed restrictions, homeowners associations, and the hiring of landscape architects to realize this shift. So Nichols took this message to the field of real estate developers through all of the professional organizing he did with the group called the National Association of Real Estate Boards, and then into the founding of the Urban Land Institute, which helped set the agenda for discussions about how private market-driven urban renewal legislation would be written. So these are documents that came out of those very early years of the Urban Land Institute pushing policy around urban renewal. So I want to turn now to one of these post-war urban renewal cases in the book, so picking up these ideas that Nichols set in motion and seeing how they played out. So having seen more of how this shift from cul-de-sac urbanism came to pass, I want us to now look at a case of a tower in the park model to draw out the connections. So with this case, I also want to talk about how the practice of architecture is starting to adjust to a new kind of client and how the influence of funders can shift the way we understand the relationship between architecture and capital. So in this case, I'm interested in the financing. I'm interested in where the money was coming from and how that influenced projects. I'm interested in urban form, so I'm curious about how these financing pressures also started to influence the way cities were shaped And I'm also interested in this category of speculative building, or thinking in some ways about what it means to design a building for a generalized market condition, or how we can think about more kinds of group-authored projects. So the history of architecture has well covered the work of modernist architect Ludwig Mies van der Rohe, from his early work in Germany to his time at the Bauhaus, to his emigration to the United States, his leadership at the Illinois Institute of Technology in Chicago, and then the residential and office towers he designed in North America. So while Mies's work is well known in the United States and often studied by scholars, his collaborations with the real estate developer Herbert Greenwald, so this is Greenwald on the left and Mies on the right, and the financial pressures and the urban implications of those projects really aren't as well known, and they stand in contrast to the kind of broad strokes of American history. So at the peak of post-war, suburban, single-family boom, right, this is the Levittown era, Mies and Greenwald were building high-rise apartment towers in the center of Chicago. So I'm going to study those projects, I do in the book. I study their financing and the construction, really, of Greenwald's credibility in a rapidly professionalizing field. So in contrast to the typical developer whose goal was to turn a quick profit, and in doing so, cast aside questions of the larger environment, this is instead a story of a developer who prioritized improving the city through new apartment buildings. Greenwald wanted his projects to encourage the middle class to remain in the center of town, incorporating amenities that would appeal to that demographic, while at the same time cloaking his buildings in an aesthetic that signaled that they were modern and progressive, so a marked contrast to the aesthetic offered in the suburbs. In contrast to these single-family home developers, Greenwald promoted an alternative vision of what his mostly white, educated, upper-middle-class clientele would purchase and convinced his financial backers to support that unorthodox aesthetic. Greenwald complicates the standard story of suburbanization and consumer culture and offers another angle from which to understand a post-war building culture that accommodated architectural innovation and a Miesian aesthetic. So just as Nichols sold his subdivisions to both the banks and the consumer, Greenwald's saleskraft was evident in two different markets. He sold individual apartments to consumers, and he sold unbuilt projects to financiers. So his projects had to be appealing in both those arenas, answering the concerns of the financiers while also serving the consumer housing market. To overcome the repeated difficulty he faced in looking for traditional forms of financing in Chicago and beyond, Greenwald relied on some atypical financing arrangements, especially in the earliest projects, to help boost his business and get it going, and leveraging those successes to launch subsequent projects. So his first project with Mies used a kind of cooperative ownership scheme that attracted more financing from an insurance company. Another project with the same company gave him the experience to pursue further projects with other funders who had deeper pockets. And then eventually he shifted into using the kind of accommodations of the Federal Urban Renewal Program, which is called Title I of the Housing Act of 1949, which allowed him to expand his business beyond Chicago in markets where he otherwise wouldn't have been able to gain a toehold. So Chicago experienced a suburban boom after a severe drop in construction between the Great Depression and the end of World War II. There were new suburban homes that were subsidized by the VA and the FHA loans, and new office construction going on in downtown. White flight was, of course, emptying the city center of its white and middle-class population, leaving behind a struggling black working class that was swelled by in-migration from the American South in pockmarked neighborhoods that white elites started to cast as grounds ripe for redevelopment. So Mies and Greenwald built multifamily apartments and condo towers in the center of a Chicago when this was quite unusual, though not unheard of. And so as a kind of tie-in to this kind of post-war consumer culture, this is an advertisement, not actually for the apartments so much as it was for the appliance salesman who wanted to fill the kitchens with GE appliances. And I kind of appreciate in this is the first tower that they built together called Promontory Apartments. In the little inset image of the inside of the kitchen, it doesn't actually fit in that building. So that's not Mies's design for the kitchen. And you can tell because that little punched window with the little curtains on the side doesn't exist anywhere on that building. So it was a funny fit, right? Of the seven projects that Mies and Greenwald built between 1946 and 1959, all except the last one were funded at least in part by insurance companies whose headquarters weren't in Chicago. They were remote from the project sites. Such projects then illustrate a larger and even centuries-long trend away from locally financed construction And they start to show how big corporations directed capital towards construction loans and permanent financing. The day-to-day decisions of programming, site design, the amenities that you would include in a project, the features to highlight in their advertising, start to show how these relationships ultimately influenced projects, and suggest that the loan managers who are working for these life insurance companies should actually be analyzed as kind of active participants in the design process. The reality of the design process is that many of the actors involved, many actors are involved, and not all of them went to architecture school. So risk is a big part of any story of real estate, and risk was present at the start of this relationship between Meese and Greenwald. Greenwald was a very young 31-year-old and very inexperienced developer when he first met Meese and started to propose that they do a tower together. So on this, a page of notes from one of their early meetings together, amid negotiations around the fees for the architects, is scribbled this little note, "Terrific gamble." So though Meese's office was eager for the opportunity to build, and it was someone in Meese's office who made this note, they were also quite aware of the risks involved in working with such an untried developer, who was using a rather unusual financing scheme to get the building built. So just as Nichols was looking to reduce the risk of buying a home, Greenwald was also working to manage the risk, even the risk in the eyes of his architect, that was associated with his own ambitions of building towers. So all of these projects that Greenwald and Meese built together found financing with life insurance companies. But their involvement, I would say, wasn't always to the detriment of design. So to give you more of a sense of how this relationship between architect and financier and developer worked, I'm going to describe one person, one kind of figure in this story, that was the insurer's real estate expert. His name was Clifford McIlvain, and he worked for Western and Southern Life Insurance, which was a Cincinnati, Ohio-based company, again, not Chicago. We'll use this as a kind of window into how the insurers started influencing design. And I think it gets back to this question of who it was that was financing some of really the most canonical buildings in modernist architectural history. So McIlvain, our character, was this manager of the mortgage division, and his job was to evaluate projects to help his company decide if they were investment worthy. And in doing this, he had to become really a kind of local expert in the real estate market and use this knowledge to decide which projects would likely make money and which would be too risky for them to get involved. He had a history of actually supporting rather unusual projects in Chicago, but they weren't unusual for their architectural design. They were unusual in the kind of financing that sat behind them. So he was throwing his support behind some rather non-conforming architectural projects by normative standards. And this was surprising. But he was actually perhaps more interested in the financing scheme behind it than he was in the aesthetics. So you could say that perhaps it was the financing mechanism that he was more interested in. So floor-to-ceiling glass windows in an apartment in a residential tower had really never been built before anywhere when Meese proposed them for the living and the breakfast rooms of the second project that he designed with Greenwald. The second project is called Algonquin Apartments. Meese's now iconic drawing of this, the Friedrichstrasse skyscraper from 1921, which was a kind of quintessential early modernist glass and steel tower, was still an unrealized dream 25 years later when he was working with Greenwald. Even after the success of their first project, Promontory, together, which had expansive though not yet full height glass, Meese's project for Algonquin Apartments was still a hard sell to investors. Residential design, whether it was cutting edge or not, had to really sell the idea of comfort, right? It had to make the buyer feel comfortable in it. And the investors feared that such large and vertiginous expanses of glass would have the opposite effect. Balancing risk was precisely their job, and most investors felt that this very modernist vision really tipped the scale too far towards risk, and perhaps even would scare off potential buyers. So when Greenwald took this design to possible investors, McIlvain was the only one who expressed interest. Now going back, the first project that they built together, Promontory Apartments, when it was under construction, and that's what you're looking at here, Meese and one of his associate architects visited the building after the concrete frame was up. They must have just brought this photographer along that very day. But the brick panels hadn't yet been installed, so it looked like you would expect a kind of glass floor-to-ceiling glass tower would look like. They went to the southwest corner of the top floor and envisioned this floor-to-ceiling glass living room that they wanted to do for the next project. And then Meese's associate later shared this story with a kind of uncertain McIlvain, explaining about Meese's ambition to build a steel and glass tower. This is where it gets good. So before McIlvain would make an offer of financing for this this floor-to-ceiling glass project, he performed an experiment. He wanted to see if this fear of glass was really going to be an issue of comfort, because it wasn't seen really as a safety issue, but he wasn't sure if that comfort issue was quite real. So to figure this out, he took his wife and his daughter to this bar called the Tip Top Tap in the penthouse of the Allerton Hotel in Chicago. This bar did have a section of floor-to-ceiling glass, and he had them seated, wife and daughter, seated right in front of the glass, not telling them what he was doing. When he saw that his wife and daughter, his family, were completely unbothered by their surroundings and didn't seem nervous by the floor-to-ceiling glass, he did decide to recommend the Algonquin Project for a loan. Now, for unrelated reasons, the Algonquin Project wasn't built as an all-glass tower, but Meese's associate then directly connected the success of the fiscal support from McIlvain for that project and the inclusion of floor-to-ceiling glass in 860-880 Lakeshore Drive. So there was a direct line from that little experiment to this project getting funding. We would never have had 860-880 Lakeshore Drive had he not taken his wife and daughter here. So this was an opportunity to build a really innovative design, and it was an opportunity that had eluded Meese for many decades in the past, but this project created a platform of saleability for Greenwald, so it was a plus for Greenwald too. So despite being another speculative project, the design of Meese's first steel and glass tower depended on this usually silent co-conspirator, this middleman figure who controlled the flow of capital that moved from the investors to the design team. So while the developer Greenwald was playing matchmaker, escorting this capital and design from paper to glass and steel, the funders provided the approval, which were passed through McIlvain, to release the construction money. McIlvain had to calculate the risk those panes of glass represented to his company against the returns the loan would bring. His role illustrates two important tendencies in architectural production in this area. One, the increasing bureaucratization and the financialization of investors, such as life insurance companies and big projects. And two, how life insurance capital enforced certain conventional ideas about the local real estate market while allowing leeway for design innovation in other areas. So on that, for the life insurance experts, the stats and the numbers preceded design. Here again are pages of meeting minutes from one of these early meetings with a project. They begin at the top left, read them like a book, all writing, all numbers, and then by the end, they're sketching out plans for the buildings. So as money was sent from a home office to these underwritten projects in distant cities, the loan evaluators cared little about the local conditions outside of the comps, that is, the comparable projects or aspects of projects that would be in the same neighborhood. Aesthetics, for example, was beyond their interest. In fact, when they were working on 860-880 Lakeshore Drive, one of the insurance companies that backed that project had a meeting with the design team and said, "Stop showing me the elevations. I don't care about the elevations. Don't show it to me until it's built." So they really weren't interested in that. Greenwald's previous success with promontory apartments, plus the soundness of the floor plans, which they did care about, and the kind of upmarket neighborhood comps that they were interested in following, were enough to satisfy this funder. This is that funder. So this is where their home office was at the time that they were making that decision, saying, "Please don't show me any more drawings." So given the architecture of this mutual benefit insurance's home office in Newark, New Jersey, this colonnaded and corniced neoclassical bank building, the company clearly understood that architecture could communicate a company message. The company used a rendering of its building to advertise in company postcards, like this one here, and it portrayed Mutual Benefit as a very stable financial institution. But in its investment strategy, the aesthetics, that those elevation drawings, were off the table, leaving all of those decisions up to the architects. So financialization bred normalization. If insurance companies acting as investors wanted to maximize the security of their investment, they were interested in matching these real estate comps. This didn't happen only in a pro forma. It really continued throughout the design process, through all of the design phases, and into construction. Once a life insurance company had signed on to finance a project, its real estate experts managed the approvals process that controlled the release of funds throughout design and construction. They presided over this ongoing cost-benefit analysis concerning decisions about design, materials, mechanical systems, and everything in between, using their knowledge and then enlisting other experts like appraisers of comps to determine if this price tag for each decision added to the saleability of the project. It is in this process of interfering with the design that critics would come to describe a project as kind of conceding to capitalism. So back to that very first project, Promontory Apartments. Promontory Apartments is often derided in the architectural literature as a highly compromised, speculative design that does not achieve the formal originality of subsequent Meese and Greenwald collaborations, especially 860, 880 Lakeshore Drive. So for example, architectural historian Phyllis Lambert says this about the project. Promontory was a speculative project whose design was determined largely by economic factors, and as a result, many compromises had to be made, right? So it's speculative, it's driven by economics, and the result was many compromises. So market forces, of course, played a role in the design decisions, but the dependence on market conditions is hardly unique to this project, nor is its status as speculative. I would argue that the problem lies rather in our desire to imagine that good design happens only in a bubble that's untainted by economics. The complexity of the relationship between design team, developer, and financiers is not something our simplistic pairing of the kind of capital A architect and the client can absorb. In fact, Meese didn't really make any more compromises in designing Promontory, any more or less than he did at 860, 880 Lakeshore Drive. So architectural history, I think, too often separates design analysis from market forces that influence architectural production. That is, it divorces aesthetics from market forces and design aspirations from professional practice. Canonized architects such as Meese are particularly neglected with regard to the integration of their design work within a market context. Projects of inferior design quality are then often derided as speculative and written off by historians and critics. By contrast, Meese's project with Greenwald demonstrates that innovation in the property development and financing areas actually helped enable an architectural vision. The interests of the design team, the financing partners, and the developers were alternately conflicting and aligning as they created the design. So how Meese's designs in particular responded to those conditions not only informs our understanding of Meese, but also that of architectural production and the built environment more generally. So this is the design for Promontory. This is the front entry. And Meese's team really designed, I think, a clean-lined apartment tower with its exposed concrete frame, simple brick spandrel panels, and wide expanses of glass. In many ways, the design of the project is one of the more urban of the Meese and Greenwald projects. There's an open lobby floor set back from the street with a kind of modest plaza in front, further recessed then from the upper floors, and it faces the lake. The building fills the entire width of the site, so it builds more like kind of a perimeter block building from property line to property line on the two sides, which draws then on the two kind of far bays are kind of driveways that allow cars to get to the back of the site. And so it kind of tucks the car away without drawing too much undue attention to the presence of the car. Without setbacks on the side, the building retained the kind of neighborhood street front of shared party walls rather than embracing the more suburban format of isolated buildings surrounded by open space. Thus, this transition from perimeter block building to a tower in the park is kind of in a halfway stage, you could say, in this project. And the next step, of course, would be 860, 880 Lakeshore Drive. This is one of Meese's most celebrated projects, and critics wax eloquent on the handsome proportions of the towers on the site. What we don't hear much about is how the building's massing was actually shaped by conditions beyond the inspired eye of the architect. So if I've shown you a bit how the kind of interaction with McIlvain helped provide the financing for this project, for this case I'll show a little bit of how this supposedly idealized design actually was shaped by a lot of outside factors as well. So its position on the site reflects an ongoing shift in cities towards setbacks, away from that perimeter block pattern. It was the first of Mises' multiple tower projects to be set back on the property line on at least three sides, creating a complex of buildings composed asymmetrically on an open and landscaped plaza-like space that would become his urban signature. Of course, he had done this already, explored this idea with the campus plan for IIT, but at 86880, he applied it to private apartment towers on a relatively small site surrounded by a dense urban fabric. So this move was a departure from the normal tendency of developers and architects to fill an entire site with as much building footprint as possible, and despite the creative solution, was predominantly motivated by the terms of a property sale contract. So an agreement in the sale of the site on which 860-880 was built limited the building's coverage of the site in order to preserve views to the lake, also a very Vancouver parallel kind of a story. So the building's height then was shaped also by outside forces. City building codes required that any building taller than 250 feet would need to have a smokestack, which would require, you know, taking up saleable square footage on every single floor. So it set really the maximum height then for the towers. The proportions then reflected these external legal and economic pressures on the designs that were outside of Mises' control. These proportions and the site design resulted from negotiations between a talented designer and an economic and legal context. In other words, these were not design decisions that occurred in some imaginary capitalism-free zone. So after building a number of apartment towers together, Greenwald wanted to move beyond Chicago and build Mises towers across the country, he would say. And he found the best opportunity to do so was with federal urban renewal policies offering developers subsidies to take on redevelopment projects in downtrodden neighborhoods. In 1955, Mises and Greenwald began work on their first and most ambitious of these urban renewal projects, together with the urban planner Ludwig Hilbersheimer and the landscape architect Alfred Caldwell. In a neighborhood known as Groschut, just east of downtown Detroit, they built an enclave of townhouses, row houses, and apartment towers set amid a tree-shaded landscape that contained the seeds of Mises and Greenwald's cosmopolitan vision for American urbanism. Called Lafayette Park, the project had a long history even before Greenwald arrived on the scene in 1956, and its story illustrates the complicated history of urban renewal projects across the country. Lafayette Park is also where we can mark the final stage in this transition between the transition from the tower in the park to the tower in the park urbanism, where this crossover between the tower and the park and the cul-de-sac reaches a kind of zenith. So let me offer, you can see this is the downtown Detroit and then the site outlined in red, and this on the left is an image by a drawing by Charles Waldheim that shows the existing fabric of the neighborhood decades before they came in and started renewing the site. So the red outlines is that previous urban fabric, and then the black buildings are what was finally built. So why Detroit? Why urban renewal? Detroit came to embrace urban renewal before most of the country had warmed to the idea and before federal legislation was in place. In the mid-1940s, newspapers were arguing for slum clearance and redevelopment as a way to reduce the supposed tax burden that slums represented. The vision for how to achieve a reduction in slums was to use public policy and public funds to entice private developers to build in parts of a city that they otherwise wouldn't. Redevelopment would raise property taxes and thus the city's revenues and reverse what was seen as an inevitable decline of center cities. The 1949 Detroit plan was to clear out and replace slum housing with privately built housing, presumably for low-income residents, though that didn't end up being the case. City officials believed that blight removal and new middle-class housing would increase tax revenue by raising property values. It would revitalize the decaying urban core, and it would improve the living conditions of the poorest dwellers, which it didn't. But as the plan developed, the welfare of the neighborhood's residents was completely swept aside. So here are pictures of the site after it had been cleared. So the creation of the Detroit plan did not involve the overwhelmingly black residents of the areas intended for clearance. So Groschut, the neighborhood, was 95% black. I don't know how they found this one white lady to take her picture, but they did. And instead, the city's business elites partnered with city officials to eliminate slums and to pull very much away from building more public housing. So the city cleared the land, but then, after the land was empty, they struggled to find a developer who was interested in the project, even with the massive subsidies that the city was offering. A community group proposed a plan hiring architects Minoru Yamasaki and Victor Gruen and the Philadelphia architect Oscar Stonerov to create a more detailed plan, which you see here. They wanted to propose this plan as a way to kind of attract developers to come and fill that empty land that they had cleared, and this was the whole idea. I want to talk about this for a minute, just because it gives such a great tie-in to this argument I'm taking on about the kind of suburbanization. So when this plan was presented in Architectural Forum magazine, it was said to be replacing a slum with a suburb. And really, the promoters of urban renewal couldn't have said it much better for me, in my argument here, to make this case that suburban development influenced downtown development. The article went on to say, and I'll read a bit of a quote while I show the images. "Many cities are searching for solutions to the same problem. Some blast and then rebuild new slums. In Detroit, where the problem was born, a new group of prominent citizens think they have found the solution. Build mixed suburbs inside the city. Mixed in building types, high-rise and low-rise, and in populations, a mingling of races. In Detroit, everyone drives to work anyway on the great new superhighways. So the plan featured easy access to superhighways and facilities for car storage for every family. This plot will be turned into a green suburb of houses and apartment buildings inside the city, urbanity after an old model." So by building a hybrid suburb in the city, the architects followed precisely the tenets that the Urban Land Institute had been promoting through its publications. No perimeter block buildings, low density, automobility-focused urban design that used open space to insulate financial risk. The plan was urban, that is, but it was but with the amenities of suburban life. All of this done just to attract a developer to bid on the site. And Herbert Greenwald, of course, would read this article and come to make a bid on the site. He got interested, he made a proposal with Mies, with Hilbersheimer and with Caldwell. He was still a small-time developer, and so this leap to working in Detroit was difficult, but urban renewal and the subsidies it offered made it seem possible to him. And Greenwald didn't attempt to build housing for the displaced residents of the neighborhood, no one was really proposing anything like that, Greenwald did support establishing the new development as racially integrated. Like most of his time, Greenwald still believed that the way to improve the urban environment was through slum clearance. He would say he wanted to tear out whole sections of cities and rebuild them, and saw this as really the only way to bring change to downtrodden neighborhoods. So this is the plan they submitted in January of 1956, Mies, Hilbersheimer, and Caldwell. Their design called for 6 apartment towers, as well as row houses and terrace housing, totaling 1,700 units, aimed at middle class and some upper middle class residents. The low-rise buildings would be financed by a cooperative ownership model, so this was what Greenwald had used before, and the towers would be financed with traditional financing from banks, four local Detroit banks. It included no public housing. In accordance with Hilbersheimer's ideas about superblock theory, major streets run around the perimeter of the site, with short then cul-de-sacs reaching into the site, and then a wide park traversing the center and dividing the site into 3 north-south bands. The image of one of the models that they built. So it actually might remind you a bit of Radburn, New Jersey, which is the image on the right. This was the plan by Clarence Stein and Henry Wright for this town of Radburn, New Jersey, from 1926 until 1933, which was another also ultimately half-completed scheme for American urbanism that reconfigured this relationship between the built environment and the natural environment, especially around this problem of the automobile. The talents of Mies' collaborators are evident in the project. Hilbersheimer's superblock design characteristically and rationally set buildings in an open landscape, separating auto and pedestrian traffic, as an idea he'd been experimenting with in recent years. The project was ideally sized for a settlement unit that he had been theorizing, a kind of semi-autonomous and pedestrian-scaled community of discrete building typologies. This central linear green space harkens back to these projects from 1931-1934, the Fish Spine project especially, though with a more orthogonal orientation like the version on the right. The housing would be arranged along the spine with civic and cultural amenities aligned along the green space and then commercial activities pushed to the perimeter. So when Mies wrote an introduction to Hilbersheimer's first American book, which was called The New City, Mies stated that cities, quote, must serve life. and that the job of the urban planner, as exemplified by Hilbersheimer, was, quote, to bring all of the elements of the city into a clear and logical order. So Hilbersheimer's plan for Lafayette Park was the most significant built work of his career, and was an opportunity for him to apply many of the concepts he had developed back in Germany, then in Chicago, and finally here in Detroit. A radical difference between the Siedlung and the slum-cleared Gratiot neighborhood, though, was the presence of opposing forces at work in the city. So while reformers in Germany were fighting the more centralizing tendencies of cities there, pulling more populations in Chicago and Detroit, it was decentralizing forces that were causing and threatening the urban core. So rather than addressing this decentralizing force with increased density, as we might want to do today, Detroit's urban planners had already determined that what this neighborhood needed were more suburban amenities, such as low density and single family houses, in order to succeed. Both plans for the site delivered. In Meese and Hilbersheimer's plan, although no single family houses were included, there was ample off-street parking, which signaled the priority given to the car, and the separation between buildings allowed suburban patterns of deep setbacks. Though they were situated in the shadows of downtown Detroit, owner-occupied units related to the street in a distinctly suburban way, buffered by green space, connected via a sidewalk to parking, and without shared lobbies or entranceways. The spatial openness of Hilbersheimer's urban plan was well-suited to Caldwell's vision of landscape architecture, in which an undulating landscape provided a counterpoint, again, to soften those hard edges of modernist architecture. As at Radburn, pedestrian traffic was siphoned to walkways along one side of the houses that led to the central spine of green space, and cars were sequestered to cul-de-sacs and perimeter roads. Caldwell smartly sunk the parking in the roadways a few feet below the first floors of the houses, in effect hiding them from the pedestrian living in green spaces of the site. This sectional change minimizes the impact of the car on the project while still accommodating it. It was this collaboration between these great designers and a developer who supported their vision that Lafayette Park was realized as a new form of American urbanism, blending suburban and modernist visions for cosmopolitan life. So though Meese and Greenwald did not collaborate on any other renewal projects of this scale, sadly due to the untimely death of Greenwald in a plane crash, other developers carried out many more projects that looked to import suburban features to downtown sites. The book carries forward with a competitor to Greenwald, William Zeckendorf, who built urban renewal projects in New York, Washington, D.C., and Philadelphia. So here is Zeckendorf, the final case study of the book on the far left, and then Greenwald, the one next to him. The model for wholesale clearance of neighborhoods was rightly criticized, and a new approach that started to favor some historic preservation in combination with surgical demolitions was on the rise. So this is a Philadelphia project by that final case study in the book, William Zeckendorf, who worked with the architect I.M. Pei. So in addition to this thread that I've laid out tonight, arguing for this suburban orientation to urban development that heavily influenced downtowns in the mid-20th century, I also really make the case in the book for the expertise of real estate developers. By the 1960s, the professionalization of real estate developers were complete. Developers had established their legitimacy as neutral experts through consulting on urban renewal and through the lobbying they had done with the Urban Land Institute. Their position and that of fields around them, such as city planning, landscape architecture, and land appraisal, had changed from where they were at the turn of the 20th century. When Nichols began subdividing land outside Kansas City, real estate developer wasn't a job title. There were no national organizations, no dedicated publications, no tomes about best practices in that field. But by the 1950s, cities could call up the Urban Land Institute, request a panel of experts to be sent in to evaluate their plans for downtown redevelopment. And by the 1960s, you could get a master's degree specializing in real estate development. The developers in this book embodied a vision of what I call entrepreneurial capitalism that worked in concert with, rather than opposed to, public subsidy. They saw the cooperation of public and private sectors as necessary, not only to their business models, but to the larger legitimacy of their profession. Nichols championed zoning as further protection for investments, and Greenwald and his fellow urban renewal developers believed the private market would simply not engage redevelopment without public subsidy. The tension between free market capitalism and professionalization even suggests the champions of the private sector still relied on a network within their field to establish social standing and professional status, without which their singular quests were not possible. This is precisely the nature of expertise that I'm interested in. It was specialized knowledge adjudicated through a network of like-minded peers. That unstable merchandise that I talked about earlier that Nichols had mentioned in 1923, that unstable merchandise might remain as shaky as ever, but it was now overseen by a cadre of experts whose knowledge and culture would buffer capital risk. So, I'll offer a bit of a coda now if you're willing to stick with me for just a couple more minutes. When Trump's candidacy last summer started to seem like it might go somewhere, I picked up a used copy of his autobiographical first autobiographical book, The Art of the Deal, ghostwritten with Tony Schwartz in 1987. Having read a number of autobiographies of real estate developers, I wondered what kind of expert would the young Trump present himself as? How would it follow the contours of other developers' careers? His Art of the Deal clearly fit into a larger genre of autobiographies by real estate developers, outlining their early days and their entry into bigger and bigger projects, putting on the airs of a kind of faux Horatio Alger story, the self-made mogul who knows everyone in town, living out the personality required of their trade, what I refer to as this practice of salescraft. So for example, one of the final case study in the book that I just mentioned was William Zeckendorf. He published an autobiography about 20 years before Trump's, and it was clearly a guiding model for Trump in tone, narrative structure, and the way that he framed the profession. So having just finished my book on the history of real estate developers in the United States, the success of his candidacy reflected, perhaps better than anything I'd found, that the prominence of real estate development in American culture was higher than ever before. So I want to talk just for a minute about his early career as a real estate developer, and I'll make this kind of an argument. Trump's early career shaped his views of three things. It shaped his views of the public, of government, and of financial regulation, and here's how. His early career shaped his view of the public in that communities would push back against his proposed projects, and he always saw them as an obstacle to what he wanted to get done. Then, his views of the government, every time he would try and get a project built, the government would also appear as an obstacle to what he wanted to get done. So he would be asking for tax breaks, bonus densities, all of these things, and he would always see the government as an obstacle to that end. And then financial regulation was the final one. It was yet another hurdle to getting whatever he wanted. So his views of the public, of government, financial regulation were all obstacles to his goals. And I'll go through quickly four projects, just a second for each, and then we'll be done, I promise, to describe that. So one of his earliest projects was the Commodore Hotel in New York City. Like other developers who came before him, Trump advocated early in his career for investing in the city center. So Zeckendorf makes the same case 20 years before, when he's negotiating for subsidies to support his redevelopment of a New York City hotel in what was then a very seedy neighborhood right around Grand Central Station. At the same time, he reflects a moment of very diminished ambitions for the city, for cities and for the public good. So this is the tower, this is the proposal of the tower. And here you can see it's Grand Central Station on the left and then this Hyatt Hotel that he basically takes an old building and just covers it in reflective glass. So the shiny, newly remodeled hotel should suffice as neighborhood improvement and therefore deserves tax breaks from the city government. He has throughout his career leveraged advantages in tax codes and municipal policy to the benefit of his projects. He went so far at one point as to lobby Congress, so this is the first time he ever appeared before a congressional committee, to repeal a set of tax reforms that, though they were designed to protect investors from undue risk, he saw as limiting his access to capital. So if you remember back last summer to the presidential debates, when he was in the second debate, he said this. He said, "I love depreciation," which is great for me because I'm always looking for an excuse to talk about depreciation, and I rarely have any popular culture reference to point to, but here I got one. So his position is this, in these presidential debates last summer, he presented himself as a kind of pro-loophole candidate who wants to continue to work the tax code and reduce regulations and reduce the size of government, aligns quite well with his career in real estate. Whatever you think of his policies as president and such public proclamations about depreciation, he represents how the financing of construction projects and the tax law are deeply intertwined. The Trump Tower, which was designed by the architects Swank, Hayden, and Connell Architects with Durr Scott, who was the kind of architect that he most often worked with, was completed in 1983. The architect, Dara Scott, actually noted that the sawtooth shape of the building literally, this is a quote, literally is to maximize the glass area in the form of corner windows from as many rooms as possible. But the part that I want to talk really about is the atrium space. So Trump describes the atrium space of the Trump Tower, as getting a density bonus from the city as a result of the legislation that considered the interior of the Ford Foundation, which is this, by the architects Roche Dinkeloo, as a public park. So Trump Tower, by including retail on the ground floor and extending the lobby through the block, could likewise claim it was a public amenity, right? This is the POPS, we would call it today, privately owned public space, and thus receive a bonus. Then by adding an atrium space as part of a park, within that, he was able to claim yet another density bonus. So this development called Trump City, that later became called Television City and finally was built as Riverside South in Manhattan's Upper West Side, he was responsible for something I'd like to call bankruptcy urbanism. So he made many concessions to civic groups in a kind of desperate state trying to get this project off the ground. These concessions improved upon what he had originally proposed, with parks and affordable housing that was added as the planning process proceeded, instead of the single massive tower isolated on a vacant plaza that he had originally proposed with the architect Helmut Jahn. So this is the first version with Helmut Jahn. After much campaigning by the neighborhood to reject Trump's proposal and desired density, the Jahn project was scrapped in favor of a new design by SOM with Cooper Robertson. The adversarial relationship in this project, one that often develops between his projects and the surrounding neighborhoods and city planners, mirrors this us against them mentality that we have seen shaping first his campaign and then more recently his time in the White House. So with Trump City, the public was really his main obstacle, and he fought their concerns until his financial situation pushed him into conceding to their demands. So this comes back to Vancouver, of course. The reports on the opening of the Vancouver Trump Tower last week described this double bind between with the Trump Organization's partner, Holborn Group. Holborn Group and the project's leader, Chia-Ju Kim, is caught between a profitable project, this polarizing figure of Trump, and a local context characterized by our mayor's public denouncement of the Trump name on a Vancouver building. The project represents this most recent phase of Donald Trump's career as a licensor, as a franchiser, of a brand, right, as a media star, whose value depends on the image of Trump himself and whose risk moves in lockstep with his political fortune. Beyond the individual figure of Trump himself, the media representation of real estate as a cultural economy or a cultural practice has overshadowed the concerns from these mid-20th century developers who sought acceptance as a class of professionals. So scholars describe different phases of capitalism. Fordism, post-Fordism, late Fordism, or late capitalism, an era of capital accumulation, some now say the capitalocene, to contrast arguments of the Anthropocene. But whatever words we want to use to describe this stage represented by a branded tower of this sort, abstracted from the individual developer's deal-making capacities and instead occupying the media image, the tweet shifting, the convention disregarding Trump, it certainly represents a stark change from the earlier generations of developers profiled in my book. The degree to which the financialization of the global economy and real estate markets more particularly have raised the stakes around questions of everything from growing income inequality to protections against risk in real estate. So let me summarize it this way. If I consider Trump as the latest generation of real estate developer, I see him as representing a different stage in the financialization of the economy than the era of developers I consider in the book. But if I consider what it means that a president came through a career in real estate to find his way into politics, then what I see in Trump's early career is troubling. If his experience was to see government, financial regulation, and the public as obstacles always to his desired ends, then that represents a pretty dark future for a model of governance that sweeps aside an older tradition of designing for the public good, for considering civic betterment as a positive goal for real estate development. Models for development that could have shaped a very different kind of politician. Thank you.